to the Dean Vaughn Music Podcast Show, hailing out of Las Vegas, Nevada. Sometimes you hit a home run, and sometimes you hit a grand slam. Well, tonight is the grand slam. I have four of the biggest names in rock and roll with me tonight, and you get to meet them all live on the Dean Vaughn Music Podcast Show. I'd like to introduce the entire band right now, Freak Show. How you guys doing?
Very good, man.
Awesome.
We're great.
Don't all speak at once.
We're very polite.
Carlos, you look great. You're at your home there.
Yes, I am in Northridge, California.
You're in Northridge? Okay. Yeah. I'm familiar with that area. It's very nice out there.
Yeah.
I want to get into Freak Show. And we're all here to talk about your new album as well, So Shall It Be. And I'd like to welcome you to the show as well. And Freak Show originally featured Frankie Benelli of Quiet Riot and Marcus Allen Christopher of Miss Crazy and Jeff LaBar of Cinderella and Tony Franklin of The Firm and, what was it, Blue Murder?
Yeah.
And we fast forward to today, 2023, actually, and we bring together the band you see tonight. So, Ronnie, give me a little background on, you know, when you thought of Freak Show and you thought of bringing the new band together.
Yeah, well, when the original thing, that was, you know, 2009, that was during, a hard time with the recession and everything.
Right.
We were under Obama. He was the shits. So it was kind of, you know, not a lot of people were, you know, wanting to tour or do albums. I mean, because, you know, money was tight, kind of like now. And, we came out with this. God, isn't that funny? I just made it funny. Realizing these shitty times is when a Freak Show album comes out, but it's almost like it brings joy, right? So yeah, we did this album, and then it just never went anywhere other than, you know, created a lot of hype. It sold, you know, a handful of copies. And now we got this band, and we were originally going to do this with Jeff LaBar, and right, he passed. So, not going into it a ton, it really sucked. And we went through a little mourning stage before we contacted Carlos. And then once we did, we put it all together, and, we want to do a little tribute to him, which we did inside the vinyl album and the CD.
Right.
And it came out great. Like, all of us together not only gave our all for that, but it's just like none of us have ever played together before. Right. So you put these people that everyone kind of knows from other things, and then you get this magic, and it's a whole different band completely, you know, sound wise, musically, you know, me vocally too.
Right.
And that first thing, I was still known as Marcus, which Facebook outed me, you bastards. But yeah, so Facebook. You know, right. So we're here, and we got this record, and it came out great. It's a lot better than I even expected.
That's awesome. Just so the audience knows who you are, Ronnie. You were the front man in Amsterdam. And with Trixie, it says you were the songwriter, guitarist, and producer of those bands. Are you also the producer of Freak Show as well?
Well, I mean, sort of, but I mean, Carlos came in not just as like a guitar player. He came in as like a producer guitar player, because right, everything, the textures, you know, the layers of this and how it all just, we all did our parts. And the way we did it too, just it came out incredible. You know, like, I can't imagine anything or anyone else doing anything that happened on this album. You know,
right?
We all made the magic, and it's really incredible. You know, but producer wise, I mean, that saying's a little overrated now.
Yeah,
I
think it's, yeah. Now you started Freak Show a long time ago. Frankie Benelli, who was in the original Freak Show?
Well, Benelli, Jeff LaBar and Tony Franklin
from Cinderella, LaBar, yeah.
Yeah. And but you know, this version, you know, it's so much more refined, and I think, you know, it has so much more electricity.
Yeah.
You know, the other one, I love, you know, and I'm grateful for playing with guys like that. And, you know, don't want to get too much involved, because it was like, you know, even though it was a good album and stuff for the time, it was kind of almost like a Miss Crazy album with a little Led Zeppelin overtones and right. different musicians, right? But it was a lot of songs that I already had. And this was, you know, fresh, and it was like written for this. And I think it really brought out the strengths of everybody in this, on this record.
Well, you've really hit a home run with this band. I mean, you got some of the best talent that you could possibly find. You got Stett over there from Wasp, and you got Carlos Cavazo from A Quiet Riot, and you've got Craig Chason, Badlands. I mean, you guys have a pretty illustrious
If someone career. Would have told me that I was going to do an album with these guys, like, I won't go a long ways into this, but I remember when I was like 14 at the Oakland Coliseum watching Whitesnake open up for Quiet Riot. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there awesome. Going, dudes, you know what I mean? Or being at the Cow Palace, you know what I mean?
You're right.
Watching The Firm play Jimmy Page up there, having no idea that one day I'd do an album with these dudes, right? Same with Jeff. You know, I've seen Cinderella like 5 times, you know, and Carlos, geez, you know, let alone that Oakland Coliseum show. I had no idea, you know, I'm this kid. And here I am, you know, playing with Stett, who's, you know, I was cranking these Wasp CDs in my freaking band while I'm on tour with Miss Crazy, you know what
right,
I mean?
It's, right, right.
And, so and then Greg, you know, let's get to Greg, though. You know, I remember when Badlands started, and it was a big hype about a new Jakey Lee band and all this. So
right.
I was right on board with that, you know, those vocals and that yeah. sound. Like right before Greg did this project, I listened to like all 3 Badlands albums, like back to back. And I was just like, you know, I'm going to have this guy, you know.
Greg, what do you think of these guys? I mean, come on, you got in this great band. How'd you meet everybody? Give me the beginning. Give me the round.
I don't like any of them, actually.
You don't like these guys?
No, I mean, Ronnie contacted me. Stett and I have been friends for a long time.
Right.
At one point, he was playing drums in Blackfoot and was trying to get me involved in that. It didn't happen. So we've been friends all the way since the 90s. Carlos and I are... probably we've met a number of times, but we're more like acquaintances than anything else, or peers, or whatever you call that, compatriots. So, you know, we all kind of know about each other, and I think we all respect what each other does. I certainly do.
Absolutely. So
when he asked me if I wanted to be involved, it was kind of a no-brainer, because I respect what Carlos and Stett, you know, brought to the table. And then also I listened to the first Freak Show record and thought, no, while this record, in my opinion, is completely different, I thought, yeah, there's something here that, you know, you could turn into something. So
would you say this is kind of a fresh start for your career, the Freak Show? Are you guys planning on, you know, taking this thing on tour? And
I'd like to do that, yes.
Well, you guys are pretty much on your way again.
We're waiting for... We're in the cherry picking mode as far as doing the live stuff. You know what I'm saying? It's like because of all the people in the band, it's got to be specific, and geographically it needs to be comfortable because some of us prefer not to fly, and some prefer, you know, we're gotcha. Trying to keep travel down to a minimum. So we're waiting. People are starting to get interested. There's offers starting, and we're gotcha. Just we're right on the cusp. You know, but we should probably talk about that after we're done with you today.
Absolutely. I want to go a little bit into your careers. I see Carlos hanging out over there. I see your dog, Carlos. What kind of dog? What's your dog's name?
Well, that's Squeaky, a small. I got a Rottweiler doing her job, barking at people right now.
Protecting the house. Carlos, I go way back with you. There, okay. There's the Rott. Beautiful dog. Wow, that's a big dog. It's a big dog.
Yeah.
Carlos, we go way back. I'm going back to Snow. Do you remember?
Oh, wow.
I'm going back to Snow. I think I played with you. I was the lead singer for Danger back in early 80s. And I was playing Club Dittos, Hacienda Heights.
That name sounds familiar. Where is that at again?
So that would be Hacienda Heights, West Covina.
Yeah.
60 Freeway up there, up that way. There was a club out there, and you were in snow at the time.
Right.
And I'll never forget it. And I played, you guys were pretty big. Snow was pretty big.
We did pretty well for ourselves, you know, got lucky, I guess. But
and then you were in Orange County at the time, right? When you,
you
raised in Anaheim Hills.
And we moved up to LA to kind of rub elbows with the big wigs and kind of edge our way in there, and it kind of works. So.
And you have a brother named Tony.
Correct.
Tony Cavazzo. In 73, you guys were out of Anaheim Hills, out that way? I used to work out in Brea.
Really? Yeah, I know that area.
I worked at Union Oil Research Center back. I was still playing.
Yeah, I went to high school out there and everything.
Right. So you went to, what was it? What high school was it?
Canyon High School, Villa Park High School.
There it is. That's awesome. Is your brother still playing music right now?
Oh, yeah. He's got Hurricane going on.
Hurricane, okay.
Yeah, he's still doing it.
That's awesome. You also, well, of course, we all know that you were in Quiet Riot. And you've done a lot in the music business and Rat. And just a little quick story on that, because I don't know. I mean, I'm not one of those guys who a history buff where I know everything about you guys. So excuse me if I don't know. But your introduction to Rat, how did that all come about when you were in Rat?
Actually, Warren had called me up and left a message. I missed his call. And, you know, he didn't say what he wanted. He just said, you know, give me a call when you have a moment. And I'm thinking, you know, what the hell could he want? I'm thinking, must be a big party going on somewhere, and you know, everybody's invited or something like that. But I called him back, and he said, you know, want to know if I wanted to work, you know, do some stuff with the band. I said, sure. So we set up a rehearsal date, and I came down and kind of worked out and went from there.
Okay. That rules.
How does it feel to be compared or to actually have replaced Randy Rhoads? One of the greatest guitar players.
Well, I never looked at it as I was replacing him because he had left the band years before we did our thing. Because the Quiet Riot that we were, it was a whole different kind of a Quiet Riot than when he was in the band.
Gotcha.
They were probably more pop. And when me and Kevin got together, we said we were trying to stick to metal sound and not be so pop. But then Come On, Feel the Noise ended up kind of being a pop song too. But
in how many years? How many years
were you? I never try to let it bother me. You know, people always say, you know, how do you follow Randy? But I just don't think about it. I just do my thing, and whatever happens. Yeah, I almost tried to jam with him one time. There was a party in Burbank, and they had a stage set up, and people were sitting in and stuff. And members of Snow and myself were up there jamming. And I saw Kevin and Randy come into the party, and I'm like, wait, come on up, you know, jam. And they weren't into it. I don't know. Maybe they had a little too much to drink, or they were just more interested in looking at girls or whatever. But I almost had a chance to jam with them. Unfortunately, it didn't work out.
Well, so I heard you had a kind of a rusty relationship with Benelli. And I don't know if you want to talk about that or not. And how did you get along with the guys, Kevin? And then,
well, you know, both those guys are a personality kind of people, and it's all about them. And
right,
they try to coerce you to follow their will, and they try to take away your voice, and they're those kind of people. And I just got tired of dealing with them, and I said, you know what, I'm done. I'm just going to move on.
It sounded like he was a bit headstrong in the band. Benelli was kind of acting as a manager.
He was really an egotist. He really was. And I wish I could sit here and say they were nice guys. But I'd be lying because they weren't nice people at all. They were just mean to everybody.
That's really sad. Why
do you be in this business to be cruel to people? Like, you know, it's like they were never happy. They weren't content being content. You know, that's they were never sad. Happy.
Yeah.
Like if there was no problem, they'd create a problem. You know,
a lot of drama sounds like.
Yeah, they like drama. They're addicted to drama.
That's
addicted to drama.
You know, I had so much fun in rock and roll, and I don't know. It never got bad for me. It never got uncomfortable. But you were at a different level in your career. Well, you couldn't just walk away or say, you know what, fuck you guys. I'm just going to go get in another band. You guys had so much success. You were kind of, and you were probably under a record contract, or you're probably under obligation. You couldn't just walk away. So you're kind of stuck with these guys.
At that point, I don't think we had a deal at that point. Not a major.
Okay. So you were with Quiet Riot for how many years were you under?
It was like 21 years, 20 plus
21. Holy shit, man. 21 years. You know, my friend Tom is in Motley Crue, and And they were talking about 40 years, you know, 40 years yeah. or something with Motley Crue. Me and Tom went to school together, and I always talk about that. We were really good friends in high school. I used to go see plays. I used to go across the street and watch him play.
Yeah.
That was my lunchtime break. But, you know, 20, 30 years, I've been in four major rock bands. Well, major, four rock bands. Say major. And they were all like 10 to 12 years, you know, run.
Yeah.
A 21-year run is amazing, and you guys had so much success.
It is.
And I believe you guys had also a top 10 album with Mental Health, didn't you?
Oh, we did. Yeah, it went number one, actually.
It went number one.
Yeah, it did.
Somebody said it topped Michael Jackson's.
It did. We were battling, like, Michael Jackson and Michael Jackson. Paul McCartney and then
Rules all right.
Richie and Donna, Dolly Parton or some kind of song. Too.
Dolly Parton, holy shit.
Oh my God, they were in the top 10, top five, and we finally knocked them out. You know?
I think technically it was the first metal album to actually be number one, if I'm not mistaken.
Probably might be,
yeah. Greg, I remember reading that it was the first metal album to go number one on Billboard.
Greg, thank you for reminding me about that, because I read an article where Quiet Riot set the trend. The first number one album, heavy metal album, and set the trend for all of the others that came about afterwards. Def Leppard, you know, everybody else. And you kind of opened the door, Carlos.
Actually, Def Leppard came out before us. They were around a little bit before, and you know.
But they just didn't have any top
people like Van Halen and Def Leppard, and
well, they had High and Dry.
Yeah, and so they were around a little bit before us. But yeah, there was probably a bunch of people getting signed after we had our success. People were, you know, thinking, hey, LA bands are successful. So I think that's great. You know, we weren't trying to do anything. We were just being ourselves, and somehow it just happened. I never thought in our wildest dreams that we'd be that successful.
Well, I also read that you wrote a handful of the songs in Quiet Riot. Is that
true? Of course, yeah. Oh, yeah. I wrote Bang Your Head.
Bang Your Head.
That was Snow's song for me, and Kevin rewrote it.
Oh, okay. That's pretty freaking awesome. Hold on.
Yeah, it was called No More Blues. And
no more
then
what?
I took the music, rewrote some of the music a little bit. Didn't need much. And then Kevin rewrote all the lyrics. Ooh. And actually, Randy Rhoads indirectly named the song Bang Your Head, believe it or not.
Yeah, tell them the story.
I was sharing an apartment with Kevin at the time in Sherman Oaks over here. And Randy had called Kevin from like, England or something like that. I don't know where he was, but you know, it was one of those things where Kevin was talking on the phone and then holding the phone, he's telling me what he was saying, you know, and he muffles the phone. He goes, yeah, Randy says there's these headbangers out there, and he'd be talking to him, you know, and then he says they all like bang their heads in unison in the front row. And then he's talking a little bit more, and they Randy says they call them headbangers.
So that term was being thrown around back in the
song written already. I rewrote all the music to No More Blues. And then the next day, Kevin goes, I'm going to name the song Bang Your Head. And I go, wow, that's kind of a weird name, but you got the inspiration from Randy. So.
Yeah.
Awesome. So I guess the headbangers originated in England.
Well, you know, the UK. Yeah. England. Yeah. You know, that's where a lot of stuff originated, right?
Right.
I've done some interviews with some bands out of the UK. It's a lot of music came out of there. God, the Who and the Beatles, and it goes on forever. That's pretty freaking awesome. And I know you got some stuff going on. Speaking of Bang Your Head, you got a website. It's called Bang Your Head Apparel.
Right.
and it's funny because I sent a text message to Vicky.
Yeah.
And she kind of mentioned that she had this apparel business. And I said, you know, you want me to throw something together for you? let me see if I could find it, because I did throw something together for you.
Oh yeah, that's awesome, man.
I was just kind of bored one day. I was putting together your slides, and Bang Your Head Apparel, and you can get in contact with bangyourhead.us. So go there and check it out. I think can they get like an autographed picture of you? And
we'll give you whatever you want, my friend. Don't worry about it.
I want one of those too. Can I?
And I see you got the Gazaris. I noticed. Well, it caught my eyes.
Yeah.
The Gazaris shirt. I was the house band.
That's all her brainstorm. You know, she's good at that kind of stuff. I help her out with it once in a while, but she runs the whole thing.
There's a QR code there. If you guys got your phone, just shoot that QR code and you'll go right to the website. And check it out, guys, because, you know, I have a couple businesses, and I know what it's like. You know, you diversify. We're musicians first, but then we do other stuff.
Right.
That is very cool. And you got a very cool wife. Very cool.
Thank
wife.
You.
Yeah, you're a very lucky cool. man. All you guys married? Is everyone married? Single? Or?
Not to each other.
We're all married.
You said all questions are okay to ask, so I'm asking: are you married?
We're all married. Well, I am. I'm sure.
Any kids, Carlos? You have children, right?
I do. I have two kids from two different women in my past relationships, and they're all like they're 33 and 36, half sisters.
Oh my gosh!
And I'm a grandfather, believe it or not, a 5-time grandfather for my younger daughter. She's got 5 kids.
Holy smoke!
Wow. I know.
And you don't look that old. You know, you are the. You look very young. And
thank
actually,
you. I'm in my 60s. So.
Oh my God! Well, all of you guys look young. You
well,
know,
thanks.
And isn't it nice? You know, we survived it all. We're still here.
We did.
Ronnie,
I'm young.
Yeah. Rock and roll kind of keeps you young because of the lifestyle.
You ever seen that picture of
You're
Sammy?
Not in the corporate world and all that
you ever
stuff.
Seen the picture of Sammy Hagar? And he's standing next to Bill Clinton. Have you ever seen
not,
that?
I have not.
Oh my God. Okay. So Sammy Hagar still looks like he's 50.
Right.
And Bill Clinton looks like he's freaking dead. I mean, he looks like he's 90, you know, 100 years old.
He might be.
I know he played saxophone, but he didn't do rock and roll like we are. You know, he didn't do it. And you're right. It's like the youth fountain. Rock and roll is like the youth.
The
fountain.
Lifestyle. You don't work and you sit around and you party all the time.
Well, we do work. We do work, you know, a little bit.
Yeah, a different kind of work, yeah.
It doesn't seem like work. I know what you're saying. And I'm saying
it's more fun, yeah. It's supposed to be fun until some people make it not fun.
Well, that's see, right. and that takes that's me right. back to how miserable that must have been for you to be in playing with how'd you and Kevin get along? You and Kevin.
I got along with Kevin better than Frankie, but both those guys are very similar in their personalities. It's like I said, they were never happy. And like, you know, we had a number one record, best-selling band in the world, but they weren't happy. Like, how could you not be happy?
How could you not be fucking happy?
I know. I couldn't What's figure those guys them? Out. I never really grew up with people like that. I didn't know how to handle people like that in my life.
And you're such a nice guy.
They're still the only person I ever people like met that are like that in this world.
But you're such a nice guy. How did you end up with this band? You know,
I don't know. They weren't like that at first. They kind of got more evil as time went on.
I think success might have went. Absolutely.
You know, that's totally true, because when Jeff and I started Freak Show, Frankie came in third and then Tony, and he effed up the whole thing like right away. Like, he took over the project, started telling us what to do, what labels we could go to, what labels we couldn't. Like, he didn't talk to me for like a week because I told him I had a connection with Nikki Sixx with 117 Records, right? And he flipped out on me. You know, an example, you know, he everything Carlos is saying, I agree with.
That is, you know, and it's very sad. It's very sad. I think success might have taken over.
I like what I'm doing now. All the bands that I work with now, they're normal people. They don't behave like that.
These guys are pretty normal, except for Stat. I'm not sure about him.
He's the pain in the
ass. No, I'm absolutely not normal, bro. No.
Like, why 16. Not? Why go out there and be fun? Not make it fun.
You know, if it's not fun, don't.
Why do it?
Why,
right?
Why do it? Why do it?
I know.
Right.
That's why I'm just blown away by the story. I've been doing a little research.
It's great. It is.
We could do a whole show on the Frankie Benelli thing. I mean, you know, right? Like, back in the day when we had MySpace, remember you had those cool players on your page? Yeah. We could play your music.
Oh, yeah. I remember.
We had a Freak Show page. And we had like 120,000 freaking friends. You know, it was really popular. And we had this song called Everyone, and it had 1 million plays.
Wow.
You know, and that was like a pretty big achievement for those days.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That would be worth all of like, what, $170 now?
Yeah. Right. On Spotify, right. I'd get $3.
Fraction of a penny. Fraction
right.
of a penny.
But either way, we had all this initiative to do all this stuff, and it was just nothing was ever good enough for that guy, you know? So we missed out on so many great things that we could have
That's
done.
That's the way they are. It's called a personality.
A type personality. Yeah, but sometimes it can get in the way. Sometimes
it does. It destroyed the band. It got to the point where, you know, it's a toxic work environment, and we couldn't even write songs anymore. It was like, you know, couldn't even be around each other anymore.
Well, just me meeting you guys for the first time, you all are pretty level-headed.
We are, all of us, yeah. I agree with that.
Nobody's wearing me down with fucking stories.
We're reasonable people, yeah.
And I see Greg Chason over there. You know, Greg, you were born August 9th. I won't say the year.
1854.
Holy shit.
Canadian.
1958 Canadian from Toronto, Canada.
Yes, sir.
And that's
pretty, nice.
Toronto.
You played in a few bands. You were in Badlands, mm-hmm. which featured former Ozzy Osbourne guitarist Jakey Lee and vocalist Ray Gillen and drummer Eric Singer and Jeff Martin. Tell me a little bit about your relationship with the guys and how that all went down. And did you guys get along? Was there any big egos in that band?
You know, we got along. I mean, Jake's my best friend. And so Jake and I have always got along. Eric was a little bit more challenging to get along with. But as time wore on, you know, while we were rehearsing and recording the record and on tour, I mean, our first tour was fairly long. So we were kind of all stuck together for 10 months or whatever it was. So Eric and I ended up becoming friends. And Ray, you know, even if Ray didn't like you, you never would know it. I mean, Ray was kind of the kind of guy that
he was kind of polite,
didn't want to deal with drama. So yeah. I was not Ray or Eric's first choice to be in the band, but I probably was Jake's. And even though I auditioned, I think that, you know, Jake was always thinking that unless I crapped the bed there somehow and blew the audition, I wouldn't get the gig. But I, you know, I ended up auditioning three times and getting the gig, and the rest is what it is. I mean,
how'd you first meet Jakey Lee?
First time I ever met Jake was, I should go back. The first time I ever saw Jake was at a party, and on the last night of the whiskey back in the early 80s, the whiskey closed for a while. Right. Right. And I went there, and I had a couple roommates, and we went and saw Black and Blue on their first show in LA, and Steeler and Rat. And Rat had Mark Turin playing guitar at the time.
Okay.
And I thought all those guys were like it was a very professional compared to, I was still living in Arizona at the time.
Okay.
Compared to what we were doing in Arizona, it was like a whole other world compared to how we were doing stuff there. We had no concept of how the big time worked, and watching bands like that, none of them had a record deal at that time, be that professional, really kind of opened my eyes. So it made me want to kind of move out here. Anyway, I went to the after party, and my roommates were pointing out who certain people were, and Jake was there. And my roommate said, well, that's Jake Williams. He plays with Dio. And he's the best guitarist in LA is how he was described to me.
Right.
So I had heard about a story. I went and actually auditioned for Rat. And before I did, I had to go down and meet Steven and Warren at Madame Wong's West in Santa Monica.
Right.
And
Rat
was, Rough Cut was playing. Jake was out of Dio at this point. He was in Rough Cut. And during their set, the power went off, except to Jake's amp and Dave Alford's drums. And they played for about 40 minutes.
That's pretty awesome.
Never seen anybody do that. And I thought, my God, that's the best guitarist I've ever seen.
Right? Who can do
so
that?
So I introduced myself to him one night at the Troubadour, just, hey, I saw you play at Madame Wong's and you're really great. And, you know, blah, blah, blah. And he was real cool. Then I went to audition for Ozzy. And one of the reasons I went to do the Ozzy audition, because I don't like flying, but the audition was in Scotland. So I had to fly over there. But one of the reasons I went is because I wanted the opportunity to jam with Jake.
Okay.
I wanted to play with the best. I thought he was the best and still do. And so I went over there. Him and I kind of hit it off, became friends. I didn't get the gig. Apparently I'm not nice looking.
And, right.
And so, but through the course of that, we remained friends, and he would always say, hey, you know, one of these times I'm going to eventually leave Ozzy, start my own band, and, you know, maybe you could be involved in it. And so that's how that kind of happened. And, you know.
Well, you were also in a band called Ghost Rose? I'm going back.
I was in a band called Ghost Rose here in
Phoenix, Arizona,
in the 70s.
Okay.
And then I was in a lot of bands. I was the biggest band I was in Phoenix was called Surgical Steel.
Surgical Steel and St. Michael, right?
Well, St. Michael, then Surgical Steel. Surgical okay. Steel had Jeff Martin in it as
gotcha. And that had been early 80s. Singer. Early 80s, yeah.
And then I moved to LA. I was in Rat for about 15 minutes. And then I
got 15 minutes. Okay.
I was in Legs Diamond for a little while. Then I was in Steeler for about a year and a half.
So then, did you, you were in Steeler. Was Rick around then? Was he playing in
Steeler? I was after Rick. I was in Steeler version 3. So gotcha. It was, gotcha. First version was Rick with Yngwie and Mark Edwards. And then the second version was Mitch Perry and Mark Edwards. And I swear I can't remember the bass player's name. He's a nice guy. I'm sorry. And then the third version was me with this guy named Kurt James, who's insane.
Okay.
And a drummer named Bobby Marks. And that was the last version of Steeler.
And then you made a move to Los Angeles, where you joined.
I was in LA at that point.
Yeah. You were in LA already. Okay. And that's when you were in Steeler, correct? Mm-hmm. And you
and
replaced
then other bands after that. Steeler turned into Keel. My brother Kenny became the bass player in Keel. And I just kind of was floating around trying to figure out where I was going.
And am I reading this right? So your younger brother Kenny,
mm-hmm.
did he replace you in that band?
No, when Ron broke up Steeler, he decided that he wanted to have a band called Keel.
Okay.
He said, if Dokken can have a band called Dokken, I can have a band called Keel. And I said, yeah, whatever. And
right.
He had originally asked me if I wanted to be in it, but I was offered to play in Michael Schenker. And so I really wanted to play with Schenker. So I said, now I'm going to do this. Well,
absolutely.
The Schenker thing didn't happen. Michael had a little bit of a detour, if you will. And by then I had recommended my brother Kenny to be the bass player in Keel, which was great. And he, you know, played on, I don't know, their first 5 or 6 records and toured all over the place.
That many albums? I thought they only had 2 albums. They have that many?
Keel?
No.
Yeah, they probably have. Well, I know my brother played on, I think, the first 5.
Oh, I didn't even know there was 5.
Yeah. They had quite a few records, yeah.
Well, Greg, after Badlands, you joined Circle of Silence.
Yes.
And that
I actually started, David Reese and I started it.
And that featured the vocalist for Accept, is that correct?
Yes, and he David was also Reese, in Bangalore Choir. And,
okay, all right.
And some other, I forget the name of the other band.
Gotcha. And what did you do right after that?
I was in that band. I got a guitar player that I knew. I played on a bunch of Christian rock records, and one of the guitarists I knew was from this band called Die Happy.
Die Happy.
I got him involved, and then we had Jay Schelling playing drums, who played drums in Hurricane, and now plays, I think, with Yes or Asia or somebody.
You played with a lot of people. Yeah.
At the time, I got offered a solo deal on the Christian label that Die Happy was on, and it was for a pretty fair amount of money, so I couldn't really do Circle of Silence and my other record. I would have to do them both at the same time, so I just kind of thought, you know what, I think I'll change gears and do this. And
okay,
I actually brought in Eric Singer to play drums on it.
Nice.
And it was kind of more of a heavy southern rock sort of record with me singing.
Wow. So you got a good voice?
No.
I love that.
I don't like it. Apparently other people did.
I had to ask, you know. And you did some work with Pat Travers. Tell me a little bit about that.
It's just a record. I did a bunch of records for Mike Varney.
Were you like a session player? Did you do a lot of work as a session, or did you actually know Pat?
I don't know if you would call it a lot, but I probably did. And there's a span there after Badlands, before, even after I moved back here to Phoenix, I played on, I don't know, maybe 20 or so albums, including a lot of Japanese guitarists would come over, or Japanese singers, and Carlos can probably speak to this. They would hire American,
right,
for lack of a better term, American rock stars to come and play on their records. So,
gotcha.
And they would pay good. And so you just show up and they'd play the song, and then you would lay down the track. I'm surprised Carlos and I didn't actually play on some tracks together. Who knows? Maybe we did. So I did a bunch of that. I did like 5 records for Barney's Blues Bureau record, and Travers's album was one of those.
Do you remember working with Greg? Carlos, do you remember doing any work with
Carlos? I don't think we ever worked together.
Yeah, we did. Didn't you sit in with the Hollywood All-Stars when I was working with them? You sat in one night, I thought, when we went through Arizona or something like that.
You know what? I split before it actually went on.
Oh, that's right. I kind of remember you were supposed
I got in a fight.
Why doesn't that surprise me?
I got in a fight, and it's not a surprise at all. I got in a fight, and the bouncers, not knowing I was supposed to be playing later, said, "You can't come back in here." So I was supposed to play, and I was one of Mike Gobby's things. He's a DJ, and I had to leave forcefully.
Greg, are you a rowdy guy, Greg?
Some people say so.
I could see you in the movie Roadhouse, you know, just knocking people.
Yeah, perfect.
also a brawler over here.
I have a certain background that,
I'm just getting that vibe. I'm getting that vibe. You seem like a super.
I like
nice
it.
Guy. You got to be a little fucking rowdy, like Ronnie.
I've had my share of adventures.
I want to move over to Stett Howland. How you doing, Stett?
Good, buddy. How you doing?
Born August 14th, 1980. Is that right?
No.
Well, 60. My eyes are blurry. 1960. Holy shit!
I should have just gone with that. No, hell no, no.
1880.
You'd have all the young girls chasing you, man. So tell me a little bit about. Okay, let's dip back just a little bit. You're the former drummer of Wasp. Were you the original drummer in Wasp?
No.
Okay.
No. Oddly, this guy, as this conversation unfolds, oddly, I came along right after Frankie Benelli.
Okay.
In Wasp.
Okay, gotcha.
What happened was Frankie had started it's the weirdest thing. At that time, I had just finished with Chris Impellitteri. I was with Chris. That's where I met Greg, actually, at Mates. I was in Impellitteri over there putting Impellitteri together. Gotcha. Greg was over there putting Badlands together at that exact same time. They were putting Mr. Big together at that time. The reason I got the Impellitteri gig was because Pat Torpey went over to do Mr. Big, and I was his replacement in Impellitteri. That was my start in L.A., you know?
You said Mr. Big. Was Billy Sheehan in that?
Yes. Yeah.
I saw him play
that. I did my time in Wasp about 16 years, actually. And
16
but I came
years?
In,
Holy
wow.
shit.
Yeah.
That's a long time.
I know.
It's a long
now,
time.
Of course,
yeah.
At the end of the day, I love Blackie. We're so tight, but I left the band, you know, I was in and out of the band over the 16 years, you know.
And you had to put up with Chris Holmes in that band. Was he in the band? Chris?
Holmes is one of my best friends. I love Chris.
I love Chris, man. Me and Chris used to party together.
Oh, God. Yeah, me too. I've known Chris long enough that I used to party with him back in the old days, but
kegs of beer, backyard parties. We'd be rolling around on the front yard. I mean, that guy was a party freaking animal.
Dumb shit said too, all of us. It was awesome. So anyway, I was roommates, Ken Hensley. I was renting Kenny a room at my condo. And he was actually recording the Crimson Idol record, you know, and Frankie was recording it. And then I was on the side working with his producer, Mikey Davis. And Mikey had me in every studio in town after hours doing sessions and stuff. So what happened was Frankie's mom passed away, and he was and I know exactly how it feels since after my mom passed away. He was just broken. He didn't want to play. Yeah. And he was, you know, about halfway through this album, The Crimson Idol.
Gotcha.
And Mikey Davis reached right out to me, says, "Listen, man, I got this perfect recording gig for you." You know, I'm like, okay, you know. And he didn't even tell me right away what it was, you know. Right. And I went to the studio the next day, and I met Blackie, and Blackie laid everything on me. He played some of the stuff, and he told me that this drumming on this album is in the vein of Keith Moon. And I was like, dude, that's, you know, like Neil Peart and Moon are like, Buddy Rich, Neil Peart, Moon. Those are
Well,
my
I was
guys.
Just going to ask you who your influences were, and I see Buddy Rich on my radar, and I see Gene Krupa.
Oh, God, dude. Gene was a badass double bass player, you know.
Yeah.
I mean,
oh yeah, he brought up the double bass after Buddy Rich.
He was amazing. So anyway, I got pulled in. I got pulled in to be a studio drummer to finish this album, you know. And it was totally my bag, you know. What he needed in a drummer was exactly what I was capable of, and I was shocked at what a intelligent man Blackie was. I figured I'd walk in there and he'd have a bunch of tattoos and he'd be drinking Jack Daniels and we'd be doing bumps.
Right.
And, you know, and I'm not saying everything but the tattoos did happen, but he was an eloquent, intelligent guy, and he told me exactly what he wanted.
Yeah.
And we had a great negotiation, and we got right to work. Like the next day I loaded my drums in and we recorded the Crimson Idol. And then there was a little bit of space, and he immediately said, "Hey, you know, come on, and we're going on tour. I want you to come on tour with me." And, you know, and we clicked live. It was great. And it was, you know, 16 years of mostly good, you know. There was some dark times, you know, but it was mostly good.
But you were with Wasp in their peak career? Is that correct?
I came along in the second coming of the band. I came along in 90, and there was another peak in the 90s. It got quite good again. And, but I did, I think, like 11 records, you know.
Wow. Okay.
I did a lot.
That's a long run.
It was a little caustic, the relationship now and then. And Frankie and I shared drum duties on several of the records. And many times it was presented as to pit us against each other.
Right.
But we never did. We always maintained respect, you know, and it was nice, you know.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
But I can't say that I don't see what Carlos is talking about a little bit. And I've heard stuff, you know, being a little bit domineering and taking over the business, you know, and stuff like that. But drummers do that. I do that shit too. You know what I mean?
I've never had a problem with drummers in my career.
No.
Drummers have always been the easygoing, just everything's just cool.
I'm the first guy that's normal.
As far as I'm concerned. Yeah, this is our video for a song called You Shine, which I wrote for my wife.
I'm not afraid to
And we just heard You Shine by Freak Show. Ronnie, tell me a little bit more about that video and what went into the song.
It was a song that I wrote for my wife. I just felt it was time that I wrote something that really identified who she is as a person. And I'm really glad it came out the way it did. It's just, you know, it's a great song, some great dynamics, and some great harmony vocals, and, you know, some amazing guitar playing by Carlos on the main solo, and then his outro solo stuff is just really incredible.
Well, you can't beat having Carlos Cavazo on the lead guitar on any song.
Right. So,
Stan, I'm going to jump around. I'm going to jump around a little bit. You did some work with Lita Ford.
Yes. Yeah, I did a comeback record.
Okay. I met Lita. She came into my studio once. I was doing a New Year's Eve concert. I played with a friend of mine, Danny Berry, who was the guitar tech for Chris Holmes. And that's how I met.
Okay.
I was in the band Danger, and Chris Holmes came to my studio, and he was dating Lita Ford for a short stint.
Yeah. And I think got married.
Oh, they did get married.
They were married. Yes.
I didn't know they got married, but they came in. I was playing in a barn in Pasadena, and Lita and Chris walked in and sat in the corner. She came up and sang a song with me. It was, you know, whatever, Rock and Roll by Led Zeppelin. And I'm swinging the mic. I used to like to swing the mic, and I hit her in the head with my microphone. And Chris got so upset at me. He goes, "Why'd you hit my wife?" And I think they were married, because I remember him saying, "Why'd you hit my wife in the head with a microphone?" I go, "Dude, I was just an accident." Man.
Right?
And she was all fine. But that was my first meeting with Lita. But I love her. I love Lita Ford. I've been watching her lately, and she's just all over the place, man. She's got a great personality. And what was your relationship with her? I mean, what did you think?
Oh, Lita and I were best friends. We're about the same age. And okay. My friend Danny Stanton is he's an agent manager. He does big stuff. And he had Lita big. Well, I don't care. What do I care now? I'll tell you. He had Lita $100,000 gig at Sweden Rock, a headlining show for 100 G's. Wow. And he needed to put the band together, and I kind of, it's weird, but I'm a drummer, but I'm a musical director as well in a lot of situations. And
okay.
In this situation, yeah. I kind of got pulled in as an umbrella guy, because I do I help with bookings, I take care of travel, you know, I'm kind of a deal maker. So I had to pass Jim Gillette's approval. that was the thing. That was the weird thing at the time, you know. And as it happens, me and him we became best friends. Then we became enemies, and now we're best friends again. Thank God, because he's one of the very few people that I know that can beat my ass.
Bring me to light on Jim Gillette. Bring me to light. Who?
Oh,
I see Gillette. Carlos. Carlos is cracking up for some reason. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I know who Jim Gillette is.
You don't want to mess around with Jim Gillette. I don't even want to mess around with Jim Gillette.
Brother. Carlos, who is Jim Gillette? Who is he?
Oh, I know who he is. I think I might have met him once or twice.
Michelangelo, dude.
Yeah.
Okay.
He was the singer in my other brother, Todd, who was in Tough. He was one of the singers. He came from Phoenix when my brother Todd moved to L.A. to start Tough, and he was the singer there. And I saw him outside of the country club beat up two guys. And
holy shit.
He was the real deal. He was the real deal.
Instead,
dude, and now he's even more Nitro. The real deal.
I got stories. Okay, I can tell you a few things. First of all, he is an awesome.
He's a great guy.
Great dude. Those Lita and Jim are not good. They had a party.
A falling
out. Lita is still my dear friend. She was just here in Fort Myers. I went over and hung out with her and Bobby Rock and the guys at the
I
ranch.
Love Lita. I love her. She's great.
She's a pumpkin. She's amazing. And but Jim is a true badass. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I've never got my ass kicked like I and I've dropped more than two people at a time myself. But I got in. Jim has a octagon at his house, a true UFC octagon. I'm not kidding you. And he trains with the Gracies of jiu-jitsu with the Gracies.
Holy
and he
shit.
Has Olympic boxing champions come over his house to teach
he's
him.
A
boxing.
Badass, yeah.
Jesus. Dude, he's the best. I'll be honest. He's the toughest guy I think I've ever. Had my hands on me before. He's a badass. But
now,
you.
Did you work
he's
on?
My bro.
That's fucking cool. That's cool. He's your bro. So you guys still see each other? You still hang out?
Yeah, we've reconnected. Okay, so the end of Lita went kind of ugly, you know. It just, there was stuff going on. And I was just like, it's time for me to go. And we were kind of enemies for a minute.
Okay.
And then I got cancer, you know, and I was in the hospital dying. They gave me like 3 weeks to live. I was stage 3 with Burkitt's lymphoma. And they're like, you're probably not going to make it.
Wow.
And it was, it got on Facebook and Jim reached out to me. He's like, Statman, I got to tell you something. I've been mad as shit at you for a couple of years now, but I thought about it. And when I think of you lying there, possibly dying, I just want you to know that I love you more than I think I hate you. So I guess I love you. And I don't know how you feel. And I started crying, you know, because I'm dying. I'm like, yeah, I can love you, man, you know?
right.
You know,
that's fucking awesome.
But Lita is my dear friend. She's always been done right by me. She's a wonderful lady. And yeah, she's a sincerely good friend. So it's kind of weird, you know.
You did an album. You did an album with Lita Ford as Wicked Wonderland. Was it Wicked Wonderland?
Yeah.
Okay. You played drums on that album.
Yep.
And you have a studio in Southwest Florida?
I'm in Fort Myers.
You're in Fort Myers, okay.
Fort Myers, Florida. And I have it's like a compound thing. It's a bar, with a bar with a showroom, a little VIP area. And I got a recording studio up there. And I do all my records here. I recorded the drums for Freak Show here, even though it's not credited on the record, but that's okay.
I'm sorry about that, dude.
I don't care. I don't care, brother. I'm just fighting around. I'm fine. I love what I do care about is that the amazing groovy riffs you sent me that allowed me to lay down some pretty badass, you know, backbone grooves that aren't representative of Neil Peart or any of those influences. Really, I really tried to control myself, you know, because I knew it was about the groove on this record. So it was like a little bit of work.
That's very cool.
I love it.
Just real quick, a little bit about Metal Church. I missed that part. You were in Metal Church? What was that all about?
Metal Church, amazing band. I had taken a break from the business after Lita. My dad had cancer, and it was about a 3-year process of him getting diagnosed and dying. And I said, I've done a lot of rock and roll in my life. I'm going to hang out with him and try and help him through it. And it was about 3 or 3.5 years. I kind of took a break from everything. And then when he passed, I looked at my wife and I was like, you know, babe, I think I got to, I never do reach outs. The universe just provides for me. I don't put ads out to get gigs, just gigs find me, you know?
I
said, you know, babe, I think this time I'm going to reach out to a few friends. And then like the next day, almost Steve Unger from Metal Church called me and he's like, hey man, this is unofficial, but Jeff Plate is going to step down from Metal Church. And the guys are wondering if, you know, you might be interested in doing the gig. And I was like, of course I'd be interested in the gig. And he was like, well, we can't offer you a big salary like probably Wasp, but what we will do is give you an equal piece of the band, and we win together, we lose together. And I was like, dude, that's more appealing than any salary you could offer, you know.
Absolutely. Now
it's up to us to do well, you know. And we did. So Metal Church, we just had a top 20 record. Our last record was top 20 in 6 countries, one of which being America.
Okay.
We just had an amazing year last year. We toured most of the year and had unprecedented numbers. And it was just an amazing time. And then when we finished in Australia this year, our guitar player, Kurt, has ruptured discs in his back, is what he's been dealing with. So he was, by the end of last year's tour, and he was really uncomfortable. And although we were supposed to start again in March, March 20th, we were supposed to start. He's like, guys, I got to take care of me now. And we're all like, you know, it's like, it sucks to interrupt the role. We were on like a good role, but you know, if your bro's like, hey, I got to take care of me, you gotta respect that.
You gotta take care of yourself. Absolutely.
Yeah. So that's where it's at. So we're shut down for the year. And, I got other, you know, we have the Freak Show, which is definitely a priority and an amazing band with lots of opportunity. And as I said before, no one's rushing into doing shitty gigs. You know, that's not who this band is.
This
is more of a higher echelon situation. And I mean, you know, I'm the one that booked all the Metal Church shows. You know, I used to do a lot of the booking with Wasp and stuff. And, you know, so
you're instrumental.
I'm in the middle of it all. And I'm hearing the offers and we're, you know, we're probably going to have a band discussion about true intentions for live shows, you know, because we're at that point now. But
you guys are all back together. Ronnie, tell me about the new album. let's dive back into Freak Show, what your intentions are with the new album. But no more lineup changes. You guys are good to go. Ronnie?
Well, I'd like to have this nucleus of, you know, what we have right here. If it works out financially for everyone involved in just like Stet says, you know, we don't want to do any shitty gigs and we want to do everything right. So if it works out for everyone, you know, I hope not, but, I think, Greg's got some things where, you know, he's secure in his situation. He's doing really well.
Right.
It'd have to be, you know, a good thing. And I think, you know, I have a lot of faith in Stet and his business ability and his booking talents and all that stuff. I trust him, and he's looking out for all of us. You know, we got a great lineup here.
Yeah.
And having it, you know, having Carlos Cavazo in this and, you know, and how he played on this new album, it's like, you know, he channeled some of the greatest, I mean, he's did some of the best Carlos stuff on there, but he also went deeper into that, you know. I even said this to Carlos. I said, dude, there's a couple Randy Rhoads style things in here. And he just laughed, you know what I mean, which is kind of a great response because, you know, his connection to it all. But this album really brought out the best of all of us, and it's so insane that I'm a part of it again in a situation like this.
But do you kind of pinch yourself once in a while?
Yeah, I slap myself across the face, actually.
You know, and I can kind of relate to that, you know. I've never played with anybody as big as you guys, really. My bands were pretty small, but you know, very talented bands. I've been in great bands, but to have the success that all of you have had in the music business is pretty incredible. You've all done. In fact, I was thinking before I did this podcast show, I go, how am I going to interview four guys who've been in the business 40, 50 years and have done multiple albums, and they have these huge discographies. And I'm like, this is going to be a 10-hour show. And I said, I got to crunch it down into at least 1 hour, you know. So how do I do that? So I'm talking to Carlos Cavazo from Quiet Riot and Rat. I've got Stet Holland, right? You know, Wasp, Surgical Steel? No, what am
Metal
I thinking?
Church.
Metal Church. And then I've got Ronnie, you know. Now, Ronnie, how far does Freak Show go back? I caught some of your early stuff, but I was a little confused as to who started the band.
I did two albums with Miss Crazy, and that's where I changed my name to Marcus Allen Christopher because I wore makeup and stuff.
Right. I saw the makeup.
Yeah. I just wanted to change completely. I sang different than I never sang like that before. New name, new everything. And then again, you know, the recession started.
Right.
You know, when Obama became president things were in the shits. Yeah.
It fucked everything up.
Yeah. So here we are. And I was talking to LeBar about doing a solo album or something. I don't know. I just wanted to do something different. And then once we got Frankie, we called it Freak Show. Then we got Tony, and then we did the album. And, you know, that was 2009, you know, and then I did like 8 Miss Crazy albums after that and stayed somewhat relevant. But, you know, these guys, you know, are from like Hit Parade or magazine and like Circus magazine and shit, where I read all the articles. But this interview today is like better than that, because like I didn't even hear any of some of these things before.
Well, good. That's what I'm hoping to bring to the table, because, you know, I've been watching all you guys. You've all done interviews, and I'm like, oh my God, you know, they're just digging the history up, and what kind of guitar do you play, and what have you done? Well, we all know what you've done. Everything you guys have done is highly visible on the internet. I can look you guys up, and I kind of wanted to get a fresh perspective of the new album, where you guys are headed. And also, I was also going to ask you guys, and I'm just going to do a quick round robin, and it's going to be the highlight, your biggest highlight of your career. And it could be the biggest show you ever played or just something that happened in your career. And I just want to get, I'm going to start with Carlos. Carlos, tell me the most excitement and the biggest thing you ever did. And probably it's going to be maybe in Quiet Riot, I'm guessing, or maybe not.
Yeah, definitely with Quiet Riot. I have to say the US Festival, playing the US Festival.
That
was a really good experience. I got to meet all those bands I never met before and hang out with them backstage. And it was quite a day.
How many people attended that?
Concert? I think maybe 500,000 or 600,000.
500,000. That's just a shitload of people.
Yeah.
How was it playing in front of that many people? Do you even care? I mean,
it's probably more hard to play in front of like 15, 20 people than.
I was going to say that. I played at a wedding once.
You know, those people are all so out of it and drunk, and I saw people getting carried away. It's just so much going on.
Yeah.
You know, they're not sitting in the front row like this, you know, watching. I played at
a wedding once, and this couple asked me to play their favorite song at a wedding, and I was dripping wet. I was so nervous because it's their wedding, and they were coming aisle. They were coming down the aisle, and I'm doing I was doing Unchained Melody on the 12 string guitar.
Wow.
Yeah. I was so nervous. So I know I can relate to what you're saying. So you're behind a wall of lights. You got 500,000 screaming kids, right? You got the side fills going on. You just got, you know, you're amped up, but I understand what you're saying there. It's just like, you're less nervous. You're just out there.
Yeah. I remember they're hosing people down with the hose and all kinds of girls with their tops off.
Oh, there you go.
Way people getting crushed. It was a madhouse.
I had a feeling you had a good story there. So Ronnie, come on, give me one big story. What did you do?
I played with Buck Cherry at Arizona Cardinal Stadium, you know, where the Arizona Cardinals play inside
right,
there.
Right.
I did three nights in that place at a motorcycle rally conference, and it was just packed and I couldn't believe it. I did that with Miss Crazy. And then I played at the Hemp Fest in Seattle.
Yeah.
And that was like 15,000 outdoors right on the water.
Nice.
That was fun. Pretty cool. But, you know, these dudes, I've seen all their big gigs. So I haven't even done gigs like that. Like those, you know, US Festival, that's insane. I remember watching I think it was Showtime, wasn't that? They did that.
Oh
yeah. And then I saw the you know, bootleg cuts and stuff. That was insane, dude. I mean, seriously. And then, you know, let alone the people who all played on that. It was like Scorpions, Van Halen.
A lot of great bands, yeah.
Yeah.
And Jakey Lee with Ozzy.
Yeah.
His first gig with Ozzy, I think.
Yeah.
Wow. That was like 500,000 people there. That's awesome.
Thanks.
Stet, what about you? You got a highlight?
Well, yeah, I do. But, you know, I'm thinking while these guys are talking. in 92, Wasp, my first tour, we did Donington with Maiden. And in that same weekend, we played with Black Sabbath at Germany in Mannheim. And that was a huge show. But the Donington show with Maiden, MTV shot it. And and it was such an amazing show. But then MTV shot the show. And it was such a career-changing moment for me because the main camera shot was like blacky, but it was wide. So I was in the background and I was just a fucking octopus. I was out of my mind back then, you know? So it's like people going, what the fuck is going on back there? And so it changed my life. I went from like some drummer that was in that Impellitteri band to like everybody in Europe anyway, all of a sudden knew me, you know? And it was like, wow, it changed like in about a month, because the show aired live and then they reran it like a million times. And I was like, wow. And then all of a sudden, like the endorse everything, life just changed a lot after that show, you know?
That's fucking awesome.
It was kind of a defining moment. And then, the same weekend we played with Black Sabbath and it was my birthday.
Holy shit.
And we were freaking, they were sound checking on my birthday and I was standing in the middle of the field drinking a beer all by myself and they were playing Heaven and Hell, sound checking Heaven and Hell with Dio. You know, I was just like, this is fucking, this don't suck either. You know? So it was pretty cool, man. It was, right in that same week or weekend, were some of the most defining moments. There's been a whole bunch of exciting things that have happened since, but that was like, wow, this is what this is. It wasn't no US Festival, but it was kick-ass, you know?
That's pretty funny. Who gets to play with Black Sabbath, right?
Dude, Donington rules.
Donington's amazing. And just that MTV coverage was just like I say, literally life-changing, you know?
Well, you know, MTV, if you weren't on, you know, back in the 80s, MTV was the leader, you know, as far as music videos go. If you weren't on MTV, you probably weren't making it. in the music business.
Yeah, you get exposed to people that wouldn't even normally know who you are. They see you on TV, you know.
They see you on TV, you're a star.
Yeah, that was the best press for everybody.
Good old days.
Now it's the Jersey Shore. Then there was VH1.
Jersey Shore reunion.
Jersey Shore. And over to Doug Chason from Badlands. You know, I know you had some highlights.
Greg.
You guys, Greg Chason from
Badlands. Greg, Fred, whatever.
Back to Greg Chason from Badlands. Go ahead.
I never played any of those kind of big gigs. My brother Kenny played at the Texas Jam with Keel, and I never did Donington, although we were on the list to be in some of those kind of things. It just never happened for us for whatever reason. But the beauty of being in Badlands is, even if there was a time that we might not have all been getting along, it never mattered on stage. On stage, right. We always pulled it off every time, whatever our personal differences may have been.
Right.
It never mattered on stage. It was always just being part of a great band. And a lot of times when I would be playing, you know, whatever show we were doing, whether it was arena or even a theater or a club, I would frequently it would cross my mind that I'm in the best band in the world right now. And all that put together, you know, was kind of like that experience, what would be hard to beat for me. I've never really, you know, I've been in a lot of bands, and, you know, because I don't know, you know, what the live setting is for what we're going to do here with Freak Show, you know, where that's exactly going, that could be the very same kind of thing. But the parts of Badlands that was, you know, I was in the band almost 5 years. There was a lot of highlights for just any live show we did. So,
well, you guys were huge. Badlands, one of my favorite bands. You guys are freaking awesome.
I have a killer bootleg that's killer sound quality, man, of a Badlands show. And it's like, it's almost like album quality. I'm surprised it didn't come out. I think it's from like the King Biscuit Flower Hour or something.
Yeah, we did a couple of those. The thing about Badlands, it was interesting. It was a very, very much a musician's band. So whenever we played, like when we played in LA or Hollywood a few times, all the musicians would show up if we were
with their arms crossed.
No, you know what? We never got that.
At least, picking you apart.
The guys that were like signed, you know, we might have got that from some people that maybe weren't signed.
Right. But
whenever we would play with, we did tours with Great White and Tesla and Cinderella, and we had a lot of other bands that opened for us as well. And you could always see when you were playing that they were into it. You know, they kind of enjoyed or respected what we did. Badlands had, for our first tour, we had the sound man that these guys might be familiar with. He goes by the name Night Bob. And he was Aerosmith, Kiss, Nugent in the 70s, New York Dolls. He was their sound man. So his idea of live sound is loud. And a lot of times when we'd be playing with other bands, they'd have very minimal stage volume.
Mm-hmm.
And our stage volume, we could have this conversation on stage with some of the bands that we played with, but not when we were playing. It was friggin' loud. Jake had three Marshall stacks. I had SVT or Seymour Duncan SVT style cabinets. We were really loud. I enjoyed that part of it.
Yeah, having a really good sound man is important.
I love that.
Very important. He was the best. He was the best. And he's still a good friend of mine. Right now he's out with Ace Frehley.
Oh, he's doing work with Ace.
Yeah, he's been Ace's sound man for quite a while on all Ace's solo stuff.
Carlos, you ever do any work with Kiss? You guys played some gigs with Kiss, didn't you?
What was your makeup that you wore, Carlos?
What makeup were you wearing? No, I mean, you weren't in Kiss. You played.
I met him before. I met everybody but Paul Stanley, but they're all nice to me, and that's as far as it went. You know, just meeting. Yeah. I never did a gig with them before.
Do you think they're really done playing, guys? I mean, is Kiss really done? They said they are.
I hope they are.
What is this? This is the last tour we're ever going to do. You're never going to see us again, right?
Except for their avatars.
I grew up with Kiss, man. So
Gene,
tell me,
Gene will come up with that thing. He'll say something like, well, we're going to do one more show and then two more shows after
that.
If you wave enough money in front of any band, they're probably going to probably going to consider doing one more show or like, one more week or one more whatever.
Like Motley Crue. This is our Motley Crue. This is our last show.
Well, if there's enough money and it's high profile enough, most people are probably going to.
Well, I think the
you have to offer.
The industry kind of draws you back in. You know, there's like a magnet. There's this magnetic force. And you try to back out, you try to retire, you try to quit. And somebody says, like you said, they have enough money and enough clout to bring you back in somehow.
You're right. You're totally right.
And I could see Carlos, you know, at 75, you know, doing Mick Jagger, coming out with an oxygen tank. And, you know,
I'm kind of like that right now. I like recording with people and writing, but touring, I'm not too knocked out about anymore.
That's funny. So it brings me back to all of you guys collectively in Freak Show. Now, you are all songwriters, would I guess?
Yeah.
Every one of you writes.
Yeah.
Every one of you sings, I'm guessing. You're all singers. Carlos, do you sing?
I do. I've sang on every album I've ever done, except for the most recent records I've done, one with Freak Show. I didn't write any material or sing on that record.
Hey, what are you talking about? It says you did.
It says you did.
Well, they sent me the songs that were kind of bare, and I heard all kinds of stuff in it. So I just laid down everything that I heard, and probably half the stuff they didn't want to use. But that's no problem.
Great.
Use what they like. And,
well, I mean, Ronnie, we used 90% of that stuff that you did
was used. Yeah, pretty much it was. Yeah.
Ronnie, what made you change did you change your vocal style from the early Freak Show to a more commercial pop sound, more melodic? I've been doing a little reading about you.
Yeah, well, I mean, I did because I was kind of trying to, I do a little bit of the Miss Crazy voice in there, you know, for fans of that, but, I've always wanted to sing more, you know?
Yeah.
Do more vocal stuff, and I kind of dabble in all kinds of different things because it's just fun, you know what I mean?
Right.
Singing the same and being always the same and stuff. Yeah. That would be different if we had 15 albums, you know what I mean?
Right.
But it's like we don't. And it's just at this time in my life, it's more like a tribute to hard rock than trying to, you know, nail exactly this thing like A&R guys used to say. Well, you guys are a little all over the road, you know. Maybe if you just sing like this on all the songs, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you guys are right in the middle of heavy metal madness. And if you've been following my music podcast show, this is season 3, Heavy Metal Madness, and I've got the heaviest damn bands I've ever heard in my life. And I'm working with Curtain Call Records right now, and they're bringing me, they have 60 bands lined up for me. And I said, I got to put Freak Show in the middle of this segment because there's no way I'm passing these guys up. You know, I've got Ronnie, I've got Carlos, Stett.
We have some metal Doug. On our
no? Yeah, Greg. Doug. Don't forget Doug.
Greg Chason from Badlands. I mean, I've got four.
Who's Doug? Who is Doug?
Doug Cavasso.
Yeah, so who's going to say who's Doug? Doug Cavasso? Well, I love that.
We're all going to go by the name Doug now.
They're going to start calling
kind of
you
like
Doug.
Ramones. They're all the last name is the Ramones. All of our first names will now be Doug.
That's funny. And I also want to go right back to Stett, man. You are a miracle, Stett, and I'm so glad you're with us today, man. You know,
thank you.
And I just want to tell you, you're a grace from God. You know, and I'm sure these guys are feeling the same way.
Greg too. Greg survived cancer and Stett, and that's through the graces of Jesus. Is the way I look at it.
Greg, you too.
Well, holy shit. I would like to throw in there that I am here today because my wife Heidi Howland she's the one that saved my life. I was at the end of a metal church run. I thought I had a flu. I have a house in Cape Cod. So we ended in New York.
Nice.
I went to my house here and I'm like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take some NyQuil and sleep this off. And she's like, nah, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. And the short story is she's like, if you don't send me a picture from the emergency room within the next 2 hours, I'm sending an ambulance to the house. And I'm like, you son of a bitch. So she was right. She was right. The local hospital is like, something's way wrong. They took me to another hospital. They're like, oh yeah, you got some sort of cancer. And I'm like, oh my goodness. And they put me in the Rhode Island Cancer Center. And she's the one that figured it out and made them save my life. She was persistent. So I just want to throw that. Yeah, like God and Jesus, yes, but also my wife.
That is so awesome. Yeah. And
put that in there.
You had
doing good. I never heard
a lot of people.
I never
Oh my God.
Well, you know, he had a lot of good people praying for him too. some people that I you did. Wouldn't even.
You know, the power of prayer is strong, guys.
Yes, it is.
You can never underestimate the power of prayer.
No, no. And you guys are survivors of one of the most deadliest evil diseases that the world has ever known. And you both survived it, and you're here today to talk about it. That is fucking awesome.
Yeah.
And I just want to thank you guys also for doing the show today. It's you know, I'm so glad you guys are all here. And I'm not coming to an end. I'm just saying thank you. But I want you guys to know that. I'm just really glad all you guys are back together. Now, Freak Show is, are you guys going back in the studio, or are you just going to pump this album and go on tour? What's your future plans?
Well, we haven't even played a gig yet for this record. So
we've done a gig.
We got to at least do, you know, some shows or something. But I don't care. I'm ready to do another album anytime.
So I got you guys.
You guys
right
give
on
me the sign.
We've never
been in the same room at the same time yet.
That's amazing. I got you guys right at the cusp of your future success.
Yeah.
I know you guys are going to blow this out of the water. Am I right?
I think so.
How can you go wrong? How can you go wrong? Look who you got.
I would like to say that I think that there should be a West Coast start somewhere in the future. You know, it's like the new, everybody's over that way. So except for me, and I go wherever, you know, so.
Just come out from the East Coast and hit the West Coast. I think that would be a great move. That would be a great move for you guys. Hit the West Coast, man.
I want to hit every big city. Just bring this thing. And I want to play full on shred live. So people get to see Carlos do his amazing instrumental. Cause you know, we wrote that song specially for him, and what he did. Like I was really excited for that because
what's the name of the song, Ronnie? What was that song?
It's called Full on Shred. It's an instrumental on the album. And
Carlos, are you full on shredding on this tune?
Yeah, I didn't write the song, but I heard all kinds of stuff going through my head when I heard that. You know, the drumming was just incredible, and the riffs were incredible. Uh-huh. I heard extra stuff that I threw in there. So,
what would you relate the song to, coming from your past career? What closest sound that you can even think of?
I don't think I've ever been in a band that had that kind of a sound before. It's different for me.
And you were just screaming on the guitar through the song.
Well, thanks. I tried.
Listen, that's one of the top 10 instrumental rock guitar songs in history. And I don't care what anybody says. And I don't think any guitar player out there, you know, Van Halen, if he was around, he would have loved that.
Eddie would bow down.
Listen, seriously, that's some incredible shit on there. And I'm just glad that we're all a part of it, you know?
Well, it's all of it's incredible. Everything that went with the song is incredible.
Yeah. What Carlos did on bass and stuff that's a crazy song. And that's total metal too.
Carlos, would you say you're more comfortable in this project than you've ever been? As far as
I am comfortable in this project. Yeah. I feel comfortable. Yeah.
You guys seem like you all get along just fine. And
we're all normal people. Seems like
totally.
No egos getting out of control. Yeah. You know.
I think we just have
no fucking Benellis. No Benellis in there.
No Benellis. It's not worth it. Why be in this business to be an egotist? It's
well, and the older we get, the older you get, right? And the older I get, the more I just want to do what I want to do.
Have fun doing it.
I don't want to do anything I don't want to do. And I'm so glad to hear all you guys in harmony on that subject. You know, you guys are doing exactly what you want to do. And I really wish you guys some major success with this album.
Thank you, Ronnie.
Yeah, absolutely. And Ronnie, thank you for bringing these guys together, man.
Yeah. I looked at it as like, you know, this is a total gift from God, man. It's the only way this kind of stuff happens.
Yeah.
Where else are you going to find four guys named Doug that can all be in the same band?
I'm not going to live this one down, am I?
No.
Greg, you know, Greg, I see you still got a ponytail going on, man. You still grew your hair long. Look at that. Holy shit. Man.
I played baseball all morning. So this is my baseball hair.
Athletic look.
You know, yes. I was going to get in a band when I came out here to Las Vegas, and the guy says, "Do you have long hair?" And I go, "Well, no, I just cut it." He says, "Well, we're looking for a long-haired singer." And I said, "Well, I'm pretty good. I mean, you know, my hair is short." They didn't grow. They didn't want me to be in the band because I didn't have long hair. So I think things have changed.
You can always grow your hair.
You can grow your damn hair.
It's hard to grow. It's hard to grow talent. It's a lot easier to grow hair.
So true. Thank you for saying that. But I want to thank you guys for joining the Dean Vaughn Music Podcast Show out of Las Vegas, Nevada. And I just wish you guys the best of luck. And I hope I get a part two or a follow-up show from you guys.
Sure.
Down the road.
Thanks
for having us on your show. It's been a lot of fun.
Thank you, Carlos.
Maybe we do a Vegas show. We got to do a Vegas show, right, Stat?
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah.
Sure. Yeah. I can talk to Corey over at Vamp. We could have fun. But that,
yeah, Vamp. Yeah.
You guys come out to Vamped and I'll come down and record you guys. Maybe I can do a backstage interview or something like that.
We'll do the part two.
You can introduce the band.
That would be really cool. That would be really cool.
Yeah.
And you guys are going to, this is going to be seen in 105 countries. Right now, I looked at my stats. I'm in 105 countries. This will blow out on Spotify. This will be on all 50 plus streaming networks around the world. Along with YouTube and all the other stuff. So people are going to see this and they're going to, hopefully that's they'll awesome. Jump on board and support you guys through your new endeavors. So thank you, Carlos. Thank you, Greg.
Okay. You lost me for a second.
Thank you, Doug. Thank you, Doug. And Ronnie, and thank you, Stet, for joining the show. And I want to wish you guys best luck and good night.
Thank you so much.
See all you guys later.
All right. See you guys later, man. Peace. Love.
Say goodbye to your biggest fans. There you go, Carlos. And thank you again for joining the show, you guys. You guys are awesome. And good night.
All right, brother. Thank you. It was a great job.
Hi, I'm Carl Scavazzo, and this is It Hurts Me.